So as we continue in this time of worship, dependent on God's work, we open up his word and we ask him for his guidance. Please pray with me. Heavenly Father, thank you so very much again for your love of us in sending your son that we might know not only your character, but Lord, how we ought to live. Thank you for your kind intention, your loving invitation to behold, to believe, to follow, to be included in the things of you that others might know you and that you might be glorified. For this group of people gathered here this morning, I would ask, Lord, your blessing upon them. Specifically, that your spirit through your word would lead and guide their hearts and minds and that they indeed would be edified and built up, encouraged, equipped with your wisdom for whatever it is that you want to do in their lives. Help me to get out of the way. And Lord, to keep my thoughts on your page so that each and every person here with one heart and one voice might indeed declare that you, O God, are worthy to be praised. Amen. Today you might hear some familiar scripture like Proverbs 22:6. Train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not part from it. Right? You've heard that before. That is a proverb, a piece of wisdom, but that is a proverb, not a promise. Okay? And what I mean by that is I know plenty of incredible parents who have trained up their children in God's word, in his church family, and then each and every one of us, right? It's also true, we still have choice. We still get to make choices. And our choices, reflect our value of God, who he is, and what he's doing. So, you know, again, this is a proverb, not a promise. I will say that it's also a piece of wisdom that's proven the inverse. That is, that if you don't train up your child, the world will. Okay? The world will. So it behooves us as we continue to look, kind of today as we dive into Mark chapter 10. If you have your Bible, go ahead and open it to Mark chapter 10. Last week we looked at family relationships. We talked about our life choices and the consequence of those things and how they're affected upon other people. That same group of people have gathered together. That same group of people have gathered together. They're all still there. They're all still pursuing Jesus. Remember, said it was a great crowd. And as he's been teaching them, even through the midst of the tests of the Pharisees, there's a great crowd of people. And we're going to look or pick it up in Mark chapter 10, beginning in verse 13. Mark chapter 10, beginning in verse 13. And it said that, and they, and that's what I said before, that's the link to the same group of people that have been gathered. They were bringing children to Jesus that he might touch them, and the disciples rebuked them. But when Jesus saw it, he was indignant, and he said to them, "Let the little children come to me, and do not hinder them, for to such belongs the kingdom of God. Truly I say to you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God like a child shall not enter it." And he took them in his arms, and he blessed them, laying his hands on them. This group of parents, right? After Jesus talking about all of the different things, the hard teaching, the truth teaching about family and the different things that they have purposely sought him out. And they're bringing little kids to him to have him touch them. Now, I don't think, right, that they're in need of healing or anything. We're not talking about illnesses or something. They are just bringing their children to Jesus that he might bless them. So incredible is Christ in their lives that they want the next generation to experience that too. They're bringing the children to Jesus. You can about imagine, you know, the parents, you've seen pictures of parents lined up for anything, like get your kid's picture taken with somebody, you know, kind of deal. I mean, there's a line, it's a crowd, and they're all pressing around, and they're bringing their little children, and they just want Jesus to touch them. Right? And the disciples decide, we got to do something about this. So they get in the middle of it. And now we get the passion of the parents, the passions of the disciples. And they're like, get away. I mean, it's a pretty strong word. It's like the disciples say, don't you get it? The heavy duty stuff he's been teaching, this is grown up time. Okay? All these kids, we're trying to have grown-up time and you're bringing these kids? Jesus sees that, and this is the only use of the word in the New Testament. It says he became indignant. Okay? Your translation might say, he was much displeased. But he's indignant. His passion matches their passion. And that word indignant means that an anger aroused in him because of unjust, unworthy, just downright mean behavior. Okay? So that's what the disciples were doing. They're unjust, unworthy, mean behavior. Get away! We're having grown-up time, serious teaching. We don't have time for kids. And Jesus just meets their passion and puts them back. Stop it. So important, the lesson we're about to look at. Because we will speak to families and those family dynamics. But whether you're a parent or a grandparent, or whether you are single, have no, this is true for the whole of the church. Childlike faith. Childlike faith. Such, these children, whom you, the disciples, right? Jesus is saying, you have decided that they're not important, and I'm telling you that the kingdom of God is for such like these. And unless, Jesus steps it up one more notch, unless you, who think you're all grown up, unless you become like them, you're not in. That's got to make the grown-ups scratch their head. What? What is this grown-up stuff? What is this childlike faith? Side note. Some of you here grew up in churches, and instead of reading the English Standard Version or the NIV Version or the NASB, you remember the King James Version, right? Right? And what does this passage say? It says, right? It doesn't say let, right? It says suffer. Suffer the little children to come unto me. It's not just that you think you're all that and you know, and the kingdom belongs to these. And then he comes and he says, and unless you have faith like these little children, you don't get to enter the kingdom of God. But I'm telling you, there's an invitation. Suffer the little children to come to me. Don't hinder them. This brings us back to earlier in Mark chapter 9, where it says, if you cause one of these little ones to stumble, you might as well put a millstone around your neck and head for the lake. So important are children to Jesus. But let them come. In our culture, in our day and age, isn't a strong enough word. Because the reason why that word suffer was used is the invitation, the command of Jesus. The Greek for that word is an intense form of its root. It means to send forth, yield, lay aside, forsake, leave, cry, forgive, send. Yeah, we just say today in the United States, we just say, I will let you. Right? It's not the same passion. Do whatever it takes for them to come to me. Side note, moms and dads with everybody 3 foot and under. Well done. You're gathered here today, and we don't have nursery, and we don't have academy, and I don't know what things are like in 2021, but I do remember when my best friends were 3 foot and 3.5 foot, okay? How hard it was on a Sunday morning, right? To get everybody ready and get them fed and get them in the van and dust out the French fries from the night before and all of those things, right? And I'm just talking about getting Tammy ready. Sorry, baby, I love you. But it's hard, isn't it? With all the demands and all of the things. And I just like on my little side note, I want to say, well done. When the Bible says, you do everything to introduce these children to Jesus that he might touch them. Well done. Because that's not what the world is doing. Childlike faith. Not just unto those children, but for each and every one of us to understand. Jesus indignant. You're going to rebuke these parents? Jesus says, I'll rebuke you. Unless you become like them. So what is it about childlike faith? Childlike faith. Children. I used a word this morning that maybe it's not completely descriptive, but when we understand the group that Jesus is bringing to them, childlike faith is an innocent faith. It's a naive. They don't know. They're an open slate. It's waiting to be painted. They're an open palette. They're waiting to be painted. They're waiting for us to fill in. Okay? Now, that's not to say, that's not to say when I say that children are innocent, right? I had five of them. The Bible says we're all born sinners. That's true. Okay? That's true. Talking about rebuking. All right. But they are. They're naive. They're waiting to be trained. It's blank. Okay? And so who's going to paint on that canvas? Moms and dad, train up your children. Because if you don't, the world will. Children are corrupt without thought. No, just kidding. They are waiting. Waiting for someone to paint those pictures. Now, if that's the children, that's we got the grown-ups way of thinking. Now back to the disciples. Okay? If childlike faith is waiting to be painted, is desirous to learn, right? The grown-up version of all this is quite cynical. Right? It's skeptical of everything. Like everybody's got an agenda. And so you're not looking at things naively, waiting for someone to teach you. The grown-up version of this is like, these parents must have some outside agenda. Time for them to go. In contrast, childlike faith is trusting. Trusting. If Jesus calls us to childlike faith, we are called to trust him. Due in part, right? Children are very trusting because they recognize their need for help. They're helpless under their own. So children naturally trust. Jesus is asking us to trust. Grown-up version. We trust less because of our cynicism or our skeptical nature. And we start to judge things by our life experience. Children didn't have any life experience. It's still early. Right? So they're going to trust, but grown-ups, something else. The third element that I think there's a long list, this is just mine. The third element of childlike faith is children are believers. They will believe what you tell them. Belief is the action step of a learner. So if they're a blank slate and they're desiring, they trust you to teach them, children will believe that. The thing about it is that they're going to believe whatever you teach them, whether you teach them on purpose or whether they just see you do it. That's how powerful that is. Grown-ups? The grown-up version, in contrast to childlike faith? The grown-ups have looked through their skepticism and their life experience, and they've decided that they'll be in charge of wisdom. Which one to pursue, which one works, having this wealth of life experience, which area I will implement in what I will and will not do. The final part, at least in my mind, children are natural imitators. They imitate what they see, what they've heard, what they've learned. Grown-ups, we're called to childlike faith. And the call to childlike faith and to be imitators of God reminds me of Ephesians chapter 5. And in Ephesians chapter 5, it says, therefore, be imitators of God as beloved children, and walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us, a fragrant offering, a sacrifice to God. And when I read that phrase, a sacrifice to God, walk in love, a sacrifice. I think about, as I said before, to you parents with young children and all of the things, and to grandmas and grandpas that care for their grandchildren and for people. Maybe it's appropriate that this message is indeed on the day that we're wrapping up the Academy night, right? Because it's not just parents and grandparents, but there are groups of people in our church family who are given of their gifts in the way that God's wired them to invest in another group of people and to train them what the Bible says, who Jesus is, and the difference he wants to make in their lives. To the teachers of the Academy, to those who are leading those things, to those who have stepped up and have been invested in the next generation here within our church family, thank you. That's important too. And that's what I said before. The call to childlike faith and what God's doing is indeed true wisdom for parents and teachers, but it's true to all of us who have been called as a part of God's gracious and divine plan to be members of his family, to then imitate him and walk as he walks. Why? It's what we've been talking about. So that what brings us to faith in Jesus, our childlike faith, we remain in childlike faith. That we never cease to trust, that we never cease to believe, that we never cease to imitate God. And the warning there, right, is so, it may seem oversimplified, but to me it's so profound. Because he's rebuking his disciples. Last week, he was getting on the Pharisees. Right? But these are the guys that have spent the better part of 2.5 years with him already. They're the ones that have had all of this stuff invested. They've hung out with Jesus. They've seen crowds before. And yet the temptation is for them to get all grown up and miss the point. We need to have tender hearts, open hearts. Not only for our own faith, but because ours is a commissioning to go into the world and share with others the love of Christ. Now, I think not unique to this world, but in the day and age we live in, there are some obstacles. There's some real heavy-duty obstacles, challenges in the world we live in today that are either pressures on our own faith journey or the pressures that people encounter and those that we are called to share the love of Christ with. We're not going to step too far away, but we'll start right with the church. One of the obstacles of life transformation, one of the obstacles for a growing childlike faith modeling the kingdom call of Jesus and his love is indeed the religious institutions. Those religious institutions in the world that teach what the church can do for you on behalf of God. Ceremonially driven. Those religious institutions teach that if you do this, you're good. Go on your way. If you do this, you're good. Go on your way. If you do this, you're good. Go on your way. Now, Rock Haven, we don't have a lot of ceremonies. But we've got another one. And please listen as closely to me today as you did last Sunday. One of the things that we've taught for generation upon generation that is inhibiting life transformation, growth, right? And is propagating the grown-up mentality. As for generation upon generation, we have taught only a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. If you put your faith in Jesus, you start a personal relationship with him. If you believe in Jesus, you start a personal relationship with Jesus. Now, please hear me now. A relationship with Jesus is personal. Okay? And it's powerful. And it is the most real thing in my life. It has value in this life and the life to come, but it is anything but personal. My being included in Jesus Christ includes me in his family, in his kingdom. And in the world that we live in today, when we talk about personal relationships, what people do is they take it like the one-stop shop, and they take it and say, oh, I got a personal relationship with Jesus. I don't need to know anymore. I'm done. I'm now in charge. You told me what I needed to hear, and I'm good. And that's the slippery slope to grown-up world, where I'm not even letting Jesus lead and guide me. Did you see? I mean, you know, that I've decided now that, okay, thanks for saving me. Now I'll run the show. I'm personally accountable. I'm personally in charge. That's what the world is doing. We didn't mean it like that, but that's what the world is doing with it. We have a call to have a relationship with Jesus, not a religion. And it is personal, powerful, real, but it is there so that we're included in Christ, in his kingdom, in his family, in him, in Christ, united in oneness, so that what we imitate of his love is genuine because he's in us. Religious systems that teach you that you come here, we'll do this for you and you're good. People who have incidentally grabbed hold of personal relationship in Jesus and believe that they're good, we're covered, done, I don't need to grow. All of those things inhibit the life transformative power of the invitation of Jesus. In order to understand that more fully, we need to look at the next piece of scripture. We're not going to cover it in full, but would you look with me at Mark chapter 10, starting in verse 17? Mark chapter 10, starting in verse 17. It says, and he was setting out on his journey, and a man ran up and knelt before him. All right? So Jesus, the crowd, right? They're bringing the children to Jesus, touch them. And the disciples are like, no, get away. And Jesus, oh, wham, and he teaches them. I mean, he didn't hit them, but I mean, he hit them. Okay? And now the crowd is kind of breaking up, and the pictures are over, and you know, got all the selfies with Jesus, and they're leaving. And one guy is like, wait, before you go. And he's running. Okay? He's running, he gets in front of Jesus, he kneels before him, and he says, good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus said to him, why do you call me good? No one is good except God alone. Someday, God might bless you, and you can hear some fantastic teacher, pastor, preacher, and he'll teach you fantastic wisdom about that statement. But I'm going to put it in terms that I understand. Jesus said, why do you call me good? Right? It's like I said before, we begged the question, you know, I'm good. That's another dismissive word. You know, that's good enough. Right? Why do you call me good? You kneel before me, and now you say, good teacher. Why do you call me good? Do you not understand that only God is good? This is Jesus saying, do you know who you're kneeling in front of? I am God. All too often, one of the other things that little children do, right, is that they're all, just by their stature. I was looking up, okay? But the other thing is, they respect those who are placed above them, who are in authority above them. Teachers, policemen, firefighters, doctors, shopkeepers, moms, dads, grandmas, grandpas, right? Till they get to grown-up world. And it's a little harder to find the submission to the authorities in our life. This guy's got himself deluded. He comes, he bows in front of Jesus, and he says, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit life?" He's got one thing in mind. He wants him to say, "You're okay. You're good." Instead, Jesus says, "Do you know whom you're kneeling before?" Ladies and gentlemen, one of the things that inhibits our childlike faith is sometimes we're just a little too casual with the things of Jesus. He is God. For by him and through him all things were created, and his character, his existence demands our worship, our allegiance, and if you fight against it, one day your knee will bow anyway. King Jesus. This man falls before him and says, "What must I do?" If he'd have recognized who he was truly in front of, right? He would say, "I will do anything you ask me." Jesus said to him in verse 19, "You know the commandments. Do not murder, do not commit adultery, do not steal, do not bear false witness, do not defraud, honor your father and mother." And he said to him, in great confidence, "Teacher, all these things I have kept from my youth." And Jesus, looking at him, loved him. Please hear that. Jesus, looking at him and knowing everything about the man, he loved him. And he said to him, "You lack one thing. Go sell all that you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. And come, follow me." Disheartened by the saying, he went away sorrowful, for he had great possession. Which saying? Disheartened? Disheartened because of the saying. It was the one about his possessions. He missed the most profound saying in standing before King Jesus, kneeling before King Jesus. King Jesus extends him an invitation. Follow me. Follow me. Childlike faith that consists of our believing and trusting and imitating God is that call to follow. Not to just an attendance-minded only event, but I mean one time wanted to know each and every day so that where he's leading and guiding, we're following and working too. So to be participants in his kingdom is to be participants in the Great Commission, the Great Commandment, to in love, right? Offer sacrifice, love others in light of what Jesus, like moms and dads do all the time. Yeah, they give of themselves for the betterment of other people. This is the invitation. It's so profound. It's so beautiful. But far too many times I've heard people that have looked at this and they think it's only about money. And in part because you're going to read more about that later, the disciples think the same thing. Ladies and gentlemen, it's not only about money. This challenge, this call, his disappointment, why he couldn't progress in his faith is because Jesus gets to the heart and asks him, he says, "What must I do to inherit eternal life?" And Jesus says, "You have to give away that very thing that you consider more important than me." And in our world that we live in today, what inhibits our childlike faith to continue to grow in the world that we engage is because people have a lot of things that they won't give up. It's more valuable than Jesus. Now, that's one thing in one level, but when we understand that our actions, our behaviors train another generation, we have to wonder what we're doing. Now, I'm preaching a little bit to the choir because you're all here, moms and dads, the children and so forth and so on. But one of the obstacles in the world we live in today is what I call the weekend frenzy. The weekend frenzy starts on Friday afternoon and it goes through Sunday night. And the rest of the time, from Monday morning till Friday afternoon, your entire week is spent getting ready and prepped for what happens Friday afternoon. And again, please hear me. It's not a matter of, oh, John, now here it comes. He wants to get as many people in the church as he can. No. I have never measured life transformation and success on attendance. But what, and I know for so many people, because we've talked for so many times, right, that life and things happen and people work on weekends and things are going on, but there's an intentionality to your following of Jesus. I know in having conversations with people that is like, man, it's been busy. We've been after grandkids, and we've been after this and after that and the other, but it is so good to be together. Well, you know what that is. That's the fellowship of God, the Holy Spirit in us that unites us to things far more personal in our relationship with each other. Okay? When I'm talking about the weekend frenzy and everything that goes along with that, I'm talking about the things that we incidentally are training our children that life is all about or for them. Right? And I'm not looking at any, oh, sure, I'll look right at that family right here. See, you come late, you sit up front, feathers. Here's the thing. We live in the country. We have some livestock. We have horses. We recently had more pigs, you know, so that's fantastic. But then, like with the pigs and the horses, there's all kinds of stuff that happens on the weekend. We've made it our aim to protect those Sunday morning times that we specifically and deliberately set aside, right? Not that that doesn't mean that sometimes we go and do some, that's fine. But the intentionality of it is that I've got a responsibility before King Jesus to train up another generation that you better make sure that you're setting time aside so that, right, they understand that there should be nothing in their lives more important than Jesus. Otherwise, the thing that the church is seeming, I mean, you've gone in the library, you find book upon book upon book, that all the church has done is create consumers. They get what they want to be told and they get the good feel good, but they're not out there being involved in the kingdom of God. What happens is they become grown-ups and they say, hey, we're about grown-up stuff. When Jesus says, no, you got to become like little kids. The final obstacle is one that I hear, and you've heard it too. It's time. Oh, I don't have time. I don't have time. Or you know what? That's just not a convenient time. That's another one. Or the other famous one, I'll do it later. That's kind of my personal favorite. Okay? Or when I'm older. I'll worry about these things when my kids are older. I'll worry about these things when I'm older. Time. Time. The call to childlike faith is for us to walk in Christ's love. Now, what's fascinating to me is like just in studying the resurrection, remember when we studied, I told you when we studied the resurrection, all of a sudden you're going to be reading in the New Testament, you're going to see the resurrection is involved in everything. Resurrection, resurrected, raised by, it's everywhere. So is this word walk. Once I point this out to you, you're going to see it all over the place. Matter of fact, in Ephesians chapter 5, it says walk in love. In Ephesians chapter 4, it starts with the same theme. In Ephesians chapter 4, verse 1, it says, Paul says, I, a prisoner, urge you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling in which you've been called. What call is that? Jesus' call. Come, follow me. Then, as an imitator of God in his love, my life, our lives should look different to this generation, to the generation to come, and not only unto our kids and grandkids, but to those who do not yet know Jesus and his love. The manner in which we've been called, in verse 2, is with all humility. Are children in childlike faith? Are children humble? Generally, as a rule, they're humble. Right? With humility and with gentleness. Are children gentle? Yeah, for the most part. There's always exceptions. With patience. We're supposed to be humble, gentle, patient. Are children patient? He's not here to defend himself, so I'll tell a story. When Spencer, my oldest, was, you know, just kind of, I mean, I don't think he was even a 2-footer yet. A 2.5-footer, somewhere in there. Okay? We took him to his school screening, and he sits down with the little teacher, And she says, asking him all kinds of questions. Then she says, and what do you do if you want something to drink? Like, what do you do if you want some juice? And he says, I asked my mom if I can have some juice. And then she says, wait 1 minute. Right? Are children patient? Yeah, children are generally patient. Bearing with one another in love. You won't find at times more forgiving than a child whose parent has wronged him once. But if I continue to wrong my children, right, I will cause their little hearts to be calloused. Bearing with one another's burdens in love. There's plenty more to speak of. There's plenty more to look at. There's tons of different things that we need to look at. But grown-up stuff shouldn't be about doing everything for the next generation. Sometimes the very everythings are the distractions that keep them from following. Grown-up stuff in kingdom teaching should be about grown-ups suffering, little children suffering, the next generation suffering, the lost to come to know the love of Christ and come to know what it means to follow Jesus. We who are strong have an obligation to bear with the failings of the weak. Let each of us please our neighbor for his good and build him up. For Christ didn't please himself. For whatever was written in former days was written for our instruction, that through endurance and through encouragement of the scriptures, we might have hope. And what's more, we have that hope to share with others. Our aim, our goal should be with childlike faith to remain trusting, believing, imitating the love of Christ, so that in our lives, our own life and hope wells up, enduring and persevering in all of the things in the culture and the world around us, so that we might share with others the love of Christ and that they might truly know and follow him. Who is him? Jesus. Now this is a little extra biblical. But in the midst of heavy duty teaching like we're looking at right here, when Jesus said, truly I say to you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God like a child shall not enter it. That was right after his rebuke, right? He said, let the children come to me. I mean, he's indignant. He says, he's angry. Let the children come. For theirs is the kingdom. And unless you become like one of them, you don't get to enter. And then he took them in his arms and he blessed them. The same Jesus. He's not angrily, give me a cut. See? Right? The parents brought him, these children, to touch. But Jesus doesn't do that. He scoops them up in his arms. And I know he smiles. That's Jesus. Bring your team up. Again, I want to say thank you so very much for your commitment and love of King Jesus, for your hearts trusting, believing, imitating to others the love of God. I know it's not easy, right? When I was talking to parents with young children and I said the word suffer, they're like, yeah, suffer is more appropriate. We love you. We love you. We're here to encourage you, to walk with you, as Romans 15 says. And it also says, now may the God of endurance and encouragement grant you to live in harmony with one another in accord with Christ Jesus, that together you may with one voice glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Have a good afternoon. Thanks for being here. Talk to you soon.